is nu tijd om de volgende spreker te introduceren. Hans-Joachim Schellenhuber is een van de meest invloedrijke klimaatwetenschappers wanneer het gaat over klimaatverandering. Hij is oprichter en directeur van het invloedrijke Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research. Hij adviseert onder andere bondskanselier Angela Merkel over zaken die met het klimaat te maken hebben. Daarnaast geeft hij wetenschappelijke adviezen over het onderwerp aan leiders in de zakenwereld, ook niet onbelangrijk. En ook is hij lid van het IPCC-panel dat in 2007 de Nobelprijs voor de Vrede heeft gekregen. En als iemand ons kan vertellen over wat er precies aan de hand is met ons klimaat, dan is het wel meneer Schellenhuber. We zijn enorm blij en verheugd. Nog een bisschen geduld, bitte. We zijn enorm blij en trots dat hij in deze voor klimaatwetenschappers uiteraard buitengewoon drukke tijden, dat hij tijd heeft vrijgemaakt om hier vandaag te kunnen spreken. Hij zal zijn lezing in het Engels geven. Please welcome professor Schellenhuber.
So, dear dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, and in particular, dear youngsters to the left and to the right, I mean, I find this very nice that you give the young people the floor first here to ask questions, and I'm looking forward to your questions, of course. I can also deal with Milankovic cycle, for example. That is, in a sense, part of my lecture. And that reminds me also, you know, when we talk about big issues in churches like this, or in the parliament, or at the stock market, wherever, when the debates are in general always done by elderly people, although it's about the future, and it's about future generations. And it reminds me of this joke made by a great philosopher with the name was Marx, but not Karl Marx, Groucho Marx, actually. And he famously said, "Why should I care for future generations? What have they ever done for me?" And so you see. Anyway, my lecture, and sorry, I have to give it in English, has the dramatic title Self-Combustion, and Professor Rubrooks referred to that already, and there's a story behind, a personal story. I just published a book. The German name is Selbstverbrennung, which means self-combustion in English, and it is in a sense an autobiography, so I summarize 30 years of research on climate change and the Earth system, but also tell the story how climate science was discovered, going back to Svante Arrhenius and Milankovic and all these people over the last 100 years. My encounters with politicians like Obama, Merkel, Putin, and religious leaders like Pope Francis, whom I met last Thursday actually in Rome, and also the politics of climate change in general. So what are we going to do about it? Because the more I worked about it, the more I'm convinced it is the biggest challenge of the 21st century, and it will be a very narrow escape for humanity if we really make it. We need a lot of luck for that. And I tried to talk you through a few slides. I mean, in general, I give a PowerPoint presentation, and this is not possible here, and no, that's fine. Actually, when I had the big honor to present the encyclical Laudato Si by Pope Francis, I was invited to be the only scientist to speak there in the Vatican. Actually, they allowed me to do a PowerPoint presentation. It was the first for 2,000 years in Rome, and so in the Vatican, so that was a big honor. And actually, I thought, of course, the technology wouldn't work, but it worked fine. So, you see, we are catching up. Here I do not give a PowerPoint presentation, but I have some backup slides for you to walk you through, because We physicists always use charts and, you know, diagrams, things like that, but sometimes the images are really important. So actually I can directly match the time scale which was covered by Professor Rubrooks. It was sort of going back in time 2 million years. Actually the origin of hominoids, however you call it, so the predecessors of the Homo sapiens, that goes back probably 7 million years at least now. It's extended all the time, it's amazing. But I will sort of start 100,000 years ago. So my first chart on the top right shows you the variation of the climate, actually the global mean temperature, over the last 100,000 years. It was the last ice age. And you see tremendous fluctuations. So within decades, temperatures dropped by 10 degrees or more, and when we're rising again. This has to do a little bit with the Milankovitch cycles, but actually much more with the Gulf Stream. So we are now able to understand where the fluctuations come about. It's a detective story, really, absolutely fascinating science, because the Gulf Stream went further north, when retreated, when collapsed completely, and so on. These were traumatic times, really. And so you see the fluctuations, and when there's a red circle, again, I think quite interesting for paleoanthropologists and so on. This was in 70,000 years ago. Volcano Toba erupted on Sumatra, and according to genetic reanalysis, just a few hundred Homo sapiens survived on Earth during that time. I mean, this is still not completely proven, but that's the suspicion. So this was almost the end of the human enterprise. But because there was a dramatic cold spike at that time, and certainly the sky was covered with dust and aerosols. But the human enterprise went on, actually, and we somehow managed through the ice age. And when you see 11,000 years ago, a miracle happened, really. The climate becomes absolutely stable compared to the things. So it's like with a razor knife, you just cut across. And this is what we call the Holocene, the last 11,000 years, when agriculture was invented, and then later cities and so on. The first cities came around already 8,000 years ago. It's amazing. But you needed this absolutely stable climate to develop agriculture, because you need 20 to 50 generations in order to domesticate animals and plants, things like that. So this is the Holocene. And we are about actually to destroy this climate stability, where the human enterprise really started to thrive. So recall, 70,000 years ago, maybe a few hundred Homo sapiens, today 7.3 billion, and the predictions are 10 to 11 billion by the end of the century, unless something dramatic happens. And actually this dramatic happening is going on right now, and that is that we have been using fossil fuels, a blessing for humanity, absolutely, since the 17th, 18th century. But you have to imagine, the fossil fuels have captured sunlight more or less for 500 million years. So this was sinking into the earth in very complicated geochemical processes. And within 2 centuries, we release these 500 million years of sunlight. So this is a geological perturbation of the biggest imaginable scale. Something needs to happen. Of course, we are driving cars, we are hitting houses and flying planes, but we are interfering in a most dramatic way with the Earth system. And that is what my good friend Paul Crutzen, who is Dutch by origin and is still working in Germany now, has called the Anthropocene. We are now at the beginning of the Anthropocene, the geology of mankind. So you see in the CO2 concentration, that's the second slide here, you see that, and this was also alluded to by my predecessor, that we have now transgressed the 400 ppm line. And you have to imagine that over the last 700,000 million years or whatever, the CO2 concentration through the ice ages, through the warm ages, was just varying between 180 ppm and 280 ppm. And now within 50 years, more or less, we have now reached 400 ppm, so we have transgressed the highest ever value during the human enterprise by 45% already, yeah? And this is dramatically rising. And you see the next slide is the temperature is responding to that. And some people still think this is just a natural fluctuation, but if you look at this red spike, this is not natural, of course. It's the direct response, and it's really interesting to just reconstruct how the human brain discovered what is going on. So Svante Arrhenius, the Swedish Nobel laureate, in 1896 actually calculated single-handed on paper with a pencil the greenhouse effect by analyzing sort of infrared radiation reflected from the moon. It's a fantastic achievement. And he did it, and there may be some engineers in the room, and in order to calculate this, he had to invent finite element analysis, which engineers still use in order to construct bridges and so on. Otherwise, he couldn't have calculated it. He had no computer. And he did it single-handed. He came to the result that if we double CO2 in the atmosphere, so his first assumption was there will be 5 to 6 degrees warming of the planet, and later he corrected it to 2.1, 2.4, something like that, which is amazingly almost in line with the most advanced computer simulation we do today. Yeah? So we knew about this interference for 120 years and so on. And still there are people who say, oh, this is just bogus, this is bad science. Since when we have fleets of satellites, ships, planes, buoys, measurement instruments, ships and so on to sort of confirm all that. But it goes back to one of the big giants of science, that is Svante Arrhenius. So if you move on, you see now we are zooming into the recent past, so top left, the global temperature since 1880. And I have included actually the October data, because there has been some silly talking about a pause, a plateau, a hiatus in global warming since 1998. Now look at this figure there. That is the global mean temperature, always calculating the last 12 months. So it's a running mean. So in October, it includes November 2014, and then goes till October 2015. And next month, we will have a new point on that chart. And you see, it's since the 1960s, it's just going up, but there are, of course, fluctuations. Every physicist knows that every real curve is a wiggly curve. So you have some variation in that. And we can explain it, for example, in 2.5 decades ago, we had this Pinatubo eruption, and when you have a cold spike, when we had the big El Nino in 1997, 1998, which set large forests on Sumatra and Borneo on fire. The same is, by the way, happening right now. And when you had the cold sister of El Nino, El Nino is an anomalous warming of the tropical eastern Pacific, which recurs every 2 to 7 years. And on the back of El Nino, you have a cold spell, and this is bringing the global mean temperature down a little bit. But everybody can see there is an upward trend here. Do you see any plateau? Do you see any pause? Nothing like that. And nevertheless, scientists have published hundreds of papers to explain what, in my view, never existed. This is also what scientists do. If I get it published in Nature or Science, we are happy to have a go at it. So let's look to the most recent data. That's the next panel, to the right of that. And maybe you just focus on the smaller one with the red curve, the blue curve, and the green curve. And this is really scary, because here you have the months, and you see the blue line is 2010, that was the second warmest year so far. The green line are the monthly temperatures for the warmest year so far, last year actually. And when you see the monthly temperatures in red for this year, and the top circles in black are always the warmest years ever, the warmest months ever. And you see that now the system goes through the roof, really. So the October value is just ahead of everything else we have ever seen. Now this has to do on the one hand with global warming, of course, but it also has to do that we have a monster El Nino this year. Actually, I was a member of a small group of scientists who predicted that El Nino already in 2013. And published that, and nobody believed us, of course, with a new method developed from complex systems analysis, and turned out to be right, really. Now, this may become the biggest El Nino we ever had in recorded time. So November will also be ahead, and this year will be warmer by, on average, probably a tenth of a degree, and this is a quantum leap in climatology. In general, the warming is just 100ths. 1/10 means tenfold the average increase. So this is the year where things begin to accelerate again. Of course, there will be a La Niña maybe in 2017, and then we will have some cooling again, but the curve is clear, the direction is absolutely given. Now the next slide is interesting for two reasons. On the one hand, so lower left, IPCC, of course, it was mentioned, I'm a long-standing member of the IPCC. We were awarded the Peace Nobel Prize in 2007 with a fairly unknown Hollywood actor called Al Gore. That was a joke, of course, yeah, you are. And the IPCC, in his fifth assessment report, has given a prediction, which is, by the way, fairly conservative, that if we keep going what we are doing, business as usual, so really drilling all the oil and burning all the coal available and so on, we will follow this red line. There are lots of uncertainty, that's why it is a range, but you see that it will mean that we will have, on average, global warming by the end of the century of 4 degrees. And only if we completely change our way of doing business, when we will follow the blue line and we would stay below 2 degrees. On the right-hand side, you see now a famous diagram. It's called burning embers, whatever, traffic light diagram. It shows you how we enter the risk zone in various respects, ecosystems, large-scale elements of the Earth system, global food supply, things like that. And you see that we cannot make a crisp statement here that the world food supply will break down if we go to 2.5 degrees warming. But we will enter the high-risk zone. So that's why you have the sliding colors. And you see that the 2 degrees line, the green one, does not mean at all that we will be absolutely safe. We will be already in the danger zone in some respects. But we may avoid to go into the full risk zone. So 2 degrees is very important, but it is not a safe limit in the sense. Now, I'm very glad that A dear colleague of mine is here, who is a member of the Royal Holland Society, Rick Lehmann, so is sitting here because we together invented the diagram, which became an icon of climate science and the IPCC. It became actually so important that it was suppressed in the fourth IPCC report due to the intervention of the United States and other countries, because they said this is too telling. It is such a clear narrative that we don't want to show it to decision makers. So you should be aware of what we scientists always face. We are not just asked to find the truth, but we're also asked to tell the truth in a way which is not inconvenient to anybody. But sometimes it is inconvenient. I happen to work in the beginning of my scientific career on the foundations of quantum mechanics. So worked on very, very subtle Schrödinger equations, things like that. And of course, nobody cared what I'm doing. So whatever I found out was fine. It was good entertainment if you were able to convey it in nice words, but otherwise, everybody left me alone. If you now happen to find out something which is important for the future of mankind, then you have to mince your words. And if you come up with something like Rick and I did, which gives you an absolutely clear impression of what we are going to lose, when people say, shut up. Now, fortunately, I'm not asked to shut up here, so I continue. So what I also introduced with colleagues in the course of my career is the next slide on the right-hand side, so-called tipping points or tipping elements in the Earth system. That is the idea that if we warm up the planet, it will not be happening in a smooth, gradual way. Of course, ocean waters will warm up and certain fish stocks will migrate to the north or to the south, whatever. So there are continuous responses to global warming, but there will be also highly discontinuous responses. So you will transgress critical thresholds. And this is the iconic map, so to speak, where for the first time we tried to identify on the Earth where are the elements that will be tipped into new states, entirely new states, or also tipped into collapse if we just go up the temperature scale. And I'll talk you through a few examples which are highly relevant for our future. So you see the Indian summer monsoon, you see the big ice sheet, you see El Nino, Southern Oscillation, you see the Amazon rainforest, Great Barrier Reef, and so on. The jet stream, very important. If you ask yourself why the weather has become so chaotic, it has to do with a reorganization of the jet stream, which is an insight we have only developed over the last 10 years or so on. But let me talk in particular about the ice sheets, because they are, in a sense, the icons of what we are doing with the planet right now. So on the left-hand side now, if you go to the next slide, we are using the burning embers technique again. Rick, you recognize. This is a chart which I have submitted. It's a paper which is not even accepted now, which tells you on... So you have two things there. You have the line, which is the reconstruction of the global mean temperature since the last ice age. So you see we are rising from the ice age. This is measured, of course, till the year zero, so to speak. And then you see four different branches. And these are the different scenarios used by the IPCC. The best scenario, in a sense, the green one, means we stay below 2 degrees. That is the big transformation for sustainability, which may or may not happen. Then you have two intermediate scenarios, and the currently, unfortunately, most likely scenario, RCP 8.5, brings you to more than 8 degrees warming in the year 2300. More than 8 degrees. So you see, it's double the amplitude in terms of warming than we had since the last ice age in terms of cooling. So this is changing the face of the Earth, not for good, but for bad. And on the left-hand side now, you see with uncertainty ranges, the various tipping elements that may be transformed if you go up the temperature scale. So we have three clusters here. The first one sits around 2 degrees. Unfortunately, very sadly, with 1.5 degrees warming, we will probably lose 90% of the coral reefs already. So even the El Nino this year and next year will have a devastating effect on the Great Barrier Reef, for example. You will see the headlines next year. But if we would go up to, say, 2 degrees, it's a done deal, more or less. We will have a dieback of practically all tropical coral reefs. They may recover because of evolution, Charles Darwin, but evolution is not as quick as human interference. So in 1,000 years, new coral species will develop and will resettle there, but we will lose what is, in my view, the most beautiful sight, the most beautiful view of nature you can experience on Earth. So if you ever had the chance to snorkel across a tropical reef, it's a life-changing experience. Will our children and grandchildren ever have this experience? Isn't it extremely sad to think that we will deprive them of this opportunity? Now, if we go to the next cluster, this is 4 degrees warming and more. And this is where the Western Antarctic ice sheet will probably start to collapse, where we will have a transformation of the Amazon rainforest, El Nino dynamics will be changed. And finally, if you go to the business as usual development, the 8 degrees and more, you see that even the East Antarctic ice sheet will be melted down. This was a controversy in science for quite some time, but we have now new evidence on that, and I'll come to that later. So, 2, 4, 8, these are the rough numbers. So 2 means, and that's the next slide, that we do not know yet whether this would suffice to melt the Greenland ice sheet, which would mean 7 meter sea level rise. So we are already in the danger zone if we hold the 2 degrees line, for example. Then the next slide is about West Antarctica, and here the story is that some parts have already started to collapse, and it is a very complicated dynamics. It has to do with the grounding line of the ice shelves. So the ice is floating partly on the ocean, but it is grounded on the continent as well. If the grounding line is sort of shifted, pushed towards the interior of the continent, then you have a downward slope when it's a self-accelerating process, actually. And some parts of the Western Antarctic ice shelf have already gone beyond that critical line. So parts of the melting are already in the system, but of course we could still avoid the melting of the bigger part of it. And finally, you see this East Antarctica thing, that is a paper published this year. I have a young colleague, I think ingenious young lady, she's 29 and she's a professor already, Ricarda Winkelmann. Together with people from Stanford University, she published this paper which shows that under business as usual, if we really use all the fossil fuels in the Middle East, in Atlanta, in Alberta, in Venezuela, and so on, when we would finally melt down the East Antarctic ice sheet, and when the sea level would rise by more than 50 meters. Now, Professor Rubrooks referred to that, what happened during the last ice age, the the sea level was 120 meters lower, 120 meters lower. And of course, there was a connection then between England and the continent. And you know, this is what, the Germans were able actually to walk to England, and this is the worst thing the British can imagine. My consolation for them is that it will never happen again, of course. Huh? But you see, we have tremendous amplitudes here, and if we move on, so I refer now, there is this slide called anthropogenic rush through cryophase space, and this is contained in a paper we just got accepted by Nature, and it is more or less referring to what Paul Crutzen called the Anthropocene, in the sense that, you know, the last ice age we call the glacial as a geological era. When we had the interglacial, that is the Holocene, and if we keep on burning fossil fuels, if we enter the 4 degrees and so on, we will have a new name, actually, the Hemi, or Hemi deglacial, that is, the northern hemisphere will become ice-free completely, including Greenland. But if we keep on going, we enter the global deglacial, that is, the planet becomes ice-free. And in this paper we show, for example, this has to do with Milankovitch, for example. Now you have to listen, because you asked the question about the Milankovitch cycle. I'm also looking to the left-hand side from time to time. You see, there are just two factors that determine the long-term evolution of the ice masses on Earth. That is the insulation from the sun. The orbit of the Earth is changing all the time due to gravitational pull of Jupiter and Saturn, and the axis is tilting and preceding. And the second thing is CO2. Now, if we just take these two variables, we can reconstruct the last 10 ice ages precisely. This is really a breakthrough. But we can also predict when the next ice age will start. And under normal condition, it would start in 50,000 years from now. There are still people walking around and say, it will happen next week or in 100 years and so on. Don't talk about global warming. Global cooling is the name of the game. This is complete nonsense, of course. But it will actually happen in 50,000 years, but only if there would be no human interference. We can calculate that with the CO2 already now in the atmosphere, there will be no ice age anymore. The next ice age will be suppressed. Maybe in 150,000 years, the overnext will weigh in, but even that is very insecure. Now, if we look back in time, because time is the lab we have, not only for archaeologists, but in particular for climate scientists, we ask ourselves, well, if we hold the 2 degrees line, what does it mean in terms of sea level, for example? And you see it, that is on the right-hand side, the top slide. When we look back 125,000 years, that is called marine isotope stage, in this case, what was it, five? Sea level was, actually CO2 was about 280 ppm, pre-industrial, temperature was warmer by 1 degree, and we had at least 6 meter higher sea level. If you go back 400,000 year, isotope stage 11, it was 6 plus probably 7 meters or something. And if you go back to the so-called Pliocene 3 million years ago, this is the next analogy to a 2 degrees warmer world. And there we had 6 plus x meters, where x could have been 20 or 30 meters. Huh? So you see, the warming we are going to have will raise the sea level by 6 meters at least, at least. Why I'm telling you this? Because we are in the Netherlands, of course. Eh? Because I recall very well when we first started to work with the IPCC, when we talked to coastal engineers and so on, and urban planners, and I said, what's the big deal? We will be able to manage 12 meters sea level rise at the very least in the Netherlands. Good luck. It's not so easy as you think, because you have to manage water from behind and from above you and from what is in front of you. It's a very tricky thing. In Venice, we are just building a defense scheme for the lagoon, which will cost 30 million euro, and it's just protecting them against 20 centimeter sea level rise. So again, arrivederci, Venice, which is extremely sad again. It's, in my view, the most beautiful city in the world, but it cannot be defended against global warming. I don't think so. So we have, I talked already about the coral reefs. Another big issue, which is even more robust when global warming, is ocean acidification. No? So if I take this glass of water and would add some CO2, you turn it into sparkling water, of course. So it's mildly acidic. And this is precisely going on because the oceans are taking up at least a quarter of all the CO2 which we emit into the air. At least a quarter. These are tremendous amounts, billions every year, billions of tons. So it slightly becomes more and more acidic. And this, in the end, would mean that coral reefs cannot be built. Even if we would survive the warming, they could not be built anymore because the animals, the small animals, could not find the right chemical ambience, environment, in order to build the shales. Now let me sort of open my view. This was my narrative more or less about climate change, but this is only part of the Anthropocene, because in these days we are wasting and destroying just everything that was given to us by nature. And I think the most ugly expression of that is if, even from a satellite, you can see that in the world's oceans, you have 5 gyres of plastic. One of them, the big Pacific gyre, is as big as Europe. But just the garbage is rotating according to the wind and the ocean currents and so on. And we just throw away a bottle of plastic, it goes into a river, it is going into the sea, part of it is grounded down into smaller particles, part of it is just floating. And actually, if you go to a tropical beach now, say on the Seychelles with wonderful white beaches, a quarter of the sand is consisting of small plastic particles already. I don't want to spoil your holiday, yeah? You understand, but it is quite disgusting to think about that. And so you see the plastic paradise, two slides about it, and compare it to the beauty of a coral reef. So it's not just about food security, you know, economic growth, it's also about beauty and the opposite of beauty. Extremely hideous scenes and pictures you can see in the planet. And this is the concept that you go beyond just global warming and the atmosphere, you look into biodiversity, you look into toxic waste, you look into plastic. Together with my friend Johan Rockström and many other people, including Paul Crutzen, we developed this concept of the planetary boundaries. Where is the safe operating space for humanity where we do not interfere with nature in a way that we just destroy or spoil it? And you can see this, by the way, also a famous diagram now, planetary boundaries, that's the top, the bottom right slide, which says on climate change, we are in the red zone already. When it comes to biodiversity, we are far beyond what is acceptable. But also when it comes to nitrogen cycle and phosphorus cycle, our interference is dramatic. So let me widen the picture even more and conclude more or less. The climate crisis is one of the big crises of this century, but it's not the only one. And I'm chairing the German Advisory Council, and we prepare a new report. You can see the title will be Humanity on the Move. And we decided to do that long before the Syrian refugee crisis became apparent. I mean, it was latent all the time. Everybody knew that millions of people are somehow sort of put aside in tents and in shanty towns and so on. But that way really started to come to Europe, to Austria, Germany, Netherlands, Sweden, and so on. This happened only this year. And this has to do that we are so many people on this planet. And as I said, the latest projections by the United Nations say 10, 11 billion people by the end. But the interesting thing is not only we will be more, because we could feed the world, we could feed 11 billion people. Of course we could. As Mahatma Gandhi once said, there's enough for everybody's need, but there's not enough for everybody's greed. So we could feed 11 billion people, but where will these people live? You heard about that China has just given up the one-child policy. Probably it will not make a big difference because the Chinese couples are not willing to have many children anymore. They rather travel the world. So it's almost a desperate move now. It's not because human rights have now been accepted. So China will rather shrink in the future. India will still rise, but the continent which will really rise in population is Africa. So when I was born in 1950, 200 million people lived in Africa. In the 1970s, I traveled across the whole continent, and this continent is really dear to my heart. And now it's about 1 billion. It will be 4 billion by the end of the century. Can you imagine with 6, 7, 8 degrees warming and 4 billion people that everything will be fine? Will these people just decide to die quietly and peacefully on that continent? I cannot imagine that. And on top of that, you have this tremendous inequality. Understand that this society has some eminent business people in their ranks, which is wonderful, as well as artists and scientists. But you see, the modern global economy is just going in the wrong direction if you look at the distribution of wealth. When I presented the encyclical, I also drew up one number, which is, was debated 2 years ago, that if you rank all the people in the world, the 7 billion, according to their wealth, their income, you find that the 85 richest people own as much as the poorer half of humanity. So the 85 own as much as 3.5 billion. The number is, of course, wrong. It's only 60 people today. And next year it will be 55, because the rich, the super rich, get even richer overnight by doing nothing, more or less. Maybe just using a few mouse clicks to resettle their stocks. Well, a fisherman in the Philippines can work 14 hours a day and will not earn more than $2 a day. Or a woman working in the sweatshops for the European textile industry in Bangladesh. They have no chance. So if you take these three things together, we go through the planetary boundaries. We will be 11 billion people. And the distribution of income becomes ever more unfair. Can we imagine that this will remain a peaceful planet? I cannot muster the imagination for thinking so. So, what is the answer? We scientists, Rick Lehmanns, myself, or Bertrand Fournier, who is an eminent engineer, we cannot give the full answer to that. We can point the finger to the problem. We can even propose options for solutions, but we cannot make decisions on that. Of course, as ordinary citizens, we can change our lifestyle. We can vote for the right party. I do not mean a right party. Anyway. But the willpower has come from society at large, of course. And there are two very hopeful and encouraging developments over the last years. I will go to Paris for the climate conference under the worst possible conditions, you know, with the terrorist attacks and so on, but we have to do our job. So we will go there and we will do everything in order to get a good climate agreement. But I'm encouraged by two things. Because in the end, as I said, it's a moral decision you have to make. Everybody wants to do good business, everybody wants to be affluent and so on, that's okay. But the distribution of opportunities for leading a good life today is a distribution between those who sit at the center of the global economy, that's probably just 500 million people, and all of us sit at the outskirts, in the Philippines, in Ecuador, in South Africa, and so on. Yeah? And it's also a question of the living generations and the future generations. What we need is a social contract with future generations, actually. A social contract in the sense of Jean-Jacques Rousseau across space and time, which is the biggest challenge in the history of civilization. Whether we will be able to do that, we don't know, but we have to try very hard. Now, one thing that encourages me tremendously is that there are civil society movements now which just say, we will not leave the responsibility for the future to the politicians. Of course, they have to do what we ask them to do, but this is not sufficient. So there is this young people movement called divestment, that means started in Stanford, Berkeley, colleges in Oxford and so on, to say, if you invest money, even if you have just a small deposit at your local bank or whatever, or if you hold stocks in the market, shouldn't you try to invest only in those activities which are saving the planet and not in those that destroy the planet, like building new coal-fired power stations in Indonesia, for example, which is a good return on investment right now, or in India. So divest from those things which are destroying the future. And actually, yesterday, the biggest insurance company in the world, Allianz from Germany, which is one of the five biggest investors also, they are managing, now I have to translate it into English, so it's 2 trillion euros, 2 trillion. You have to imagine, have decided to divest from coal. That's an amazing development. This is based on, of course, avoiding risks of investment, but also based on moral concepts. And the second thing is completely different, that the Catholic Church, we are here in a Mennonite church, I understand, the Catholic Church, which is in a sense the most conservative institution in the world, has now decided to also speak out about climate change. Yeah? So the encyclical Laudato Si is a wonderful document. It's full of poetry, it's full of deep insights, it reflects the science. I'm a member of the Pontifical Academy. I had a chance to read the pre-version in Spanish because Pope Francis is Argentine. I'm almost done. And this encyclical tries to bring together two things we need in order to still overcome this crisis. And this is bringing together reason. The Netherlands are a shining example for the Enlightenment. I think Haarlem was part of it. Bringing together reason and faith. And faith does not mean you have to adore a certain God. It means faith in human values. If we bring these two things together, we can still make it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this not so happy but very necessary lecture. Any questions from students? Yes, in the far corner. What's your name?
Ich heiße Hugo. Do you think it is at this point a realistic idea to reverse the climate change, or is it inevitable?
The question is what reverse means. I mean, there are two answers to that. One is a realistic one, and one is a sort of science fiction, and not science friction one, science fiction one. We cannot reverse it in a sense. We can slow it down, we can stop it, hopefully below 2 degrees over the next 50 years or so. And I think the transformation, we have to start immediately, and we probably need to get out of fossil fuels by 2050. There are some weird ideas to really reverse climate change by so-called geoengineering. That means you, by artificial filters, you take out the carbon from the atmosphere again, or you fertilize algae in the oceans by iron, for example, or you shield off the sunlight by inoculating the stratosphere with sulfur, and even weirder schemes. As a physicist, I find it fascinating. And I even looked into that. The problem is it does not work, which is always bad, of course, if you come up with a solution or a purported solution. In the case of sucking up the CO2 again, it would work for the atmosphere, actually. I mean, there are many uncertainties. It might mean that you just cut off the precipitation from an entire continent if you do something wrong, so it's a very risky enterprise. But what we learned, and that was also published this year, is that you cannot undo the ocean acidification this way. So if we keep on doing what we are doing another 50 years or so, 100 years, the oceans will just be changed in a way which we have not seen for 20 million years. And that has to do that the oceans have an overturning time of about 1,000 years, so you cannot easily change, like the atmosphere, the chemistry. So it is decided really in the next 50 years whether we will stay with a planet which was the basis for our evolution, or we will have to move to outer space.
Thank you. Any more questions? I'll go to this side. Any one of you? Yes. What's your name?
Tim.
Hi, Tim.
What makes scientists so sure that this isn't just that this isn't a natural fluctuation in the CO2 levels?
Say it again.
What makes scientists so sure that this is not a natural fluctuation?
Okay, very interesting, because in general, only old men ask me that. And so it's very nice to hear it from a fairly young person, because if old men ask me when they say, well, you know, Professor, the climate has changed all the time over millions and millions of years, and I said, oh, you were witness of that, obviously. But I cannot say this to you, of course. So it is, of course, so that the fluctuations of the climate due to natural processes have been around all the time. As I said, Milankovitch forcing fluctuations in the carbon cycle, the type of vegetation you had, that is the albedo, for example, how much of the sunlight is reflected back. All these things we are understanding now, or we begin to unravel. But the type of change now is completely unprecedented. And it is like you would just look at the fingerprint and you see that the way the climate is changing, for example, that we have more rapid warming at night than during daylight, that has to do with the greenhouse effect. The stratosphere is rather cooling, while the troposphere is warming. So all the characteristics tell us that it's a direct human interference. And this was a big, big issue, actually, so you're absolutely right to ask that. 10 years ago, we said, oh, can we really be sure? But now we are sure. By the way, I should say, as a physicist, you are never 100% sure in science. That would be a big mistake. If somebody tells you, I'm 100% sure, when you would think he's part of a Stalinistic party or so on. But if scientists say we are 97, 98, 99% sure, it's virtually sure. It means if you do not heed that type of warning, then you are a madman, actually. Unfortunately, there are still many madmen around.
Thank you. Well, sorry, Tim. It is our own fault. Nothing to be done about that. There's time for one more question. Yep.
I'm in a commanding position. I can see people raising their hand. But
well, which way should I go, Professor? This way?
Yeah.
Okay, yep.
What can we in this church change in our everyday life to help stop global warming?
No, that is absolutely the right question, because, you know, this fight against global warming was also a story of finger pointing. So some people said, first you have to abolish capitalism and everything will be fine. But we know that in the Soviet Union, the destruction of the environment was even more aggressive than in the Western world. Others say, well, this party has to change the program. We had to introduce a carbon tax worldwide, which is all fine. The economists tell you what is the best way to save the planet. I don't mind whether we find the best way. I'm happy if we find some way, actually. And so in the end, it is really the individual person that makes the decision. I talked to some very big companies recently in Australia, and they are not afraid of their government, not at all, but they are afraid of their customers. The biggest company is just collapsing if they have no customers anymore. So if you buy something, you can make a decision. If you invest a little bit of money, or your parents do, you make a decision. Of course, if you vote, you make a decision. And, you know, I said this yesterday in a panel discussion with the head of the German trade union system. You can, because he was saying, well, the industrial system, it takes 40, 50 years to create new jobs and so on. But you can make a decision overnight. For example, you can decide overnight that you will not use the plane anymore for flying a short distance of 1,000 kilometers, for example. You can take a train. You can decide not to eat 7 times a week meat, which is not healthy anyway, because agriculture is providing about 20% of the greenhouse gas emissions, and most of them come from cattle raising. Yeah? So for 1 kilogram of beef, you have to use 10,000 kilograms of water, for example, and tremendous amount of emissions. So I think lifestyle changes are a very, very powerful thing. And I recall 10 years ago, this was said, oh, this is very romantic, and the individual can do nothing. It's all the big systems and the big companies and world politics. It's not true. In the end, the most powerful people in the world become nothing if their followers are not obeying anymore. So you can change the world.
Thank you. I was actually going to ask you if there was something you would like to say to the future generation, which you have referred to in your lecture, but I think you've already said it perfectly. You can change the world, right?
Okay.
Did you all hear that? You can change the world. Stop eating meat and stop flying. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Professor. Sure.